So my name is Zach, if we haven't met before, and it's so good to see you in person, all of you here this morning. For those of you joining us online, a special welcome to you as well. Thanks for tuning in. This weekend has already been off to an incredible start. If you didn't know, yesterday we had our Christmas food drive. Many of you were there. We thank you so much for stopping by and donating, contributing to all our efforts to help Hamilton Food Share. And just a reminder, Hamilton Food Share stocks all the food banks across the city of Hamilton. There's around a dozen or so. You might be familiar with some of these names. So Good Shepherd Centers, Living Rock Ministries, Mission Services Hamilton, the Salvation Army, both Dundas and Hamilton, Wesley Urban Ministries, and Ancaster Community Services. So maybe you've heard of those organizations, those food banks, and all the contributions that you gave yesterday is going to Hamilton Food Share, and they distribute it to all those places. So it was an incredible, incredible time. Our goal was to raise 1 ton, which is 2,000 pounds of food. Now, Hamilton Food Share isn't open on the weekends, so we don't have that number yet to share with you. So we're looking forward to announcing that this week on social media, or if you have our newsletter, we'll share it in there, and maybe even next Sunday. But what I can tell you is that we had 34 vehicles stop by. We had 71 boxes filled, and they gave us, we ordered 75 from them, and you can see behind me, that's the team, and we had Santa, and so behind you, you see 71 boxes, and we have 4 left over, so if any of you brought donations this morning with you, thank you so much. We're looking forward to filling those boxes and delivering those to Hamilton Food Share this week. And also a bonus, we raised $120 in cash that will also go towards Hamilton Food Share as well. It was super neat to see you guys, many faces there, but also our youth on Monday, our youth group, when they met here, they took flyers, the flyers that you got last week, and they distributed them all across the neighborhood. And there were so many people. I was so surprised how many people came because they got a flyer and they're like, this is incredible. Thank you for doing this. And they just showed up and they donated. And that's what we wanted to do. We wanted to invite our neighborhood, our community to be a part of this amazing cause. So I just wanted to share that with you. We're going to keep the momentum going of generosity, and that's been our theme this last couple of weeks, and it usually is for November and December. So we have a tip tap display, and we're also fundraising for Food for Kids. So from now until the end of the year, you can take your credit card, debit, phone, Apple Watch, anything that has tap, and there's $5 and $10 amounts. Roughly $10 to $15 feeds a child over the weekend through Food for Kids. So there's the $5 and $10 option. I encourage you after the service to give a quick tap as we want to raise money. I think up to date we have $760 so far going towards Food for Kids, which is incredible. And they just service so many needs to make sure kids don't go hungry on the weekend. So they make sure kids have food in the school so they can take it home with them. So many good things happening, and we're just so thankful for all of your support and generosity to make these things happen. So that's a little bit of update there. We're now also going to just transition into our message. I'll be back up after the service to give you a couple more announcements regarding Christmas. But right now we're in our last episode. But our last sermon in our 3-week series called Know Who You're For. So would you just pray with me as we hear from Dave? Heavenly Father, this morning we acknowledge your goodness and your faithfulness. We've sung praises to you, and it's just been such an incredible morning so far, God. And we just ask that you continue to speak to us as we open your word. Would you, give Dave the words to speak and allow him to share the message that's on his heart for us. So would you open our ears and our hearts to receive a powerful message from you today. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, I don't know if you've noticed this, but Christianity, in terms of however you want to talk about it, a worldview, a faith, a religious affiliation, is in the minority here in Canada and Hamilton in our area. That if you are a Christian, that is something that you've probably felt the tension of that most people around you are not. I was in Texas 5 or 6 years ago with my wife. We were visiting friends, and we happened on Saturday night to turn on the news. And as we're watching the news, the weather came on, and the weather reporter came on Saturday night and said, "And now for your forecast for tomorrow morning as you head out to church." And I was like, whoa, I've never heard that before. I have never here in Canada, here in Hamilton on Saturday night, my entire life turned on the news on Saturday night and expected them to say that here's your weather for tomorrow as you go to church, because most people here, that's not what they're doing on a Sunday morning. Now, in Texas, at least five or six years ago, there was at least a big enough chunk of the population that was expecting on a Sunday morning to go to church, that that's what they, the language that they would use on Sunday night. That's a whole bunch of us. We're just culturally, that's a big thing. We're going to church on a Sunday morning. Now, I don't want, don't get me going on what happens when Christianity is the majority in a place, geography, a country, because I often believe that that's not always a good thing. Although I really want everybody to be a Christian. That's part of my bias as a pastor and what I do. I think following Jesus is the best thing. But oftentimes in history, what we've seen is when Christianity has been linked with the majority, especially with politics, that usually doesn't end well. But I'm not going to get off on that because that's not what today is about. So don't lead me down that little rabbit hole. Except to say that it was just so different being in an environment where there was a lot of people, that is what they're thinking and experiencing, and just knowing that that's not been my experience, that here in Canada and in Hamilton, Christianity is not the majority position for people. In fact, a lot of us probably feel the tension, if you're a Christian, of living in a place where you're beliefs, some of your beliefs anyways, some of your values, what you think is most important, is not shared by most people around you. In the scriptures, a lot of the scriptures, in fact, a huge chunk of the Old Testament, some interpreters would say it is the main theme of the Jewish scriptures, the Old Testament. So much of it has to do with God's people being in exile. Being in a time and a place, being in a culture where their beliefs, their morality, their values are not shared by most people. And when you think about that, whether you're a Christian or whether you're not a Christian, but you're here today or you're watching today because you're checking things out, maybe you're investigating, just admit this with me. When we think about that idea that maybe we are some of the people who are in the minority, there is something that's intimidating about that and something that's attractive about it. Isn't that true? Something intimidating about it, obviously, because it's just easier to be part of the majority. It's easier that everybody kind of thinks like me and acts like me and we share so much. That would be an easier way to live. And so maybe growing up, if you grew up in a Christian context, you felt that little tension of I'm not like everybody else or my family's not like everybody else. Or as an adult, you came to a place where you go, man, it seems really hard sometimes to continue to believe certain things or to live certain things out or to have certain values. Maybe you've been teased or you've been made fun of. I would not go as far to say that we are in North America in any way persecuted, but that is true of a lot of places in the world and in the history of the world where Christians have been persecuted. Thank God that that's not been our experience. Most of us haven't had our lives threatened here in Canada because of our religious beliefs or our faith, although that has been true of Christians historically in a lot of places in the world. But there's a lot of things that make us uncomfortable about that, probably, if we're honest. But then, and again, whether you're a Christian or whether you're someone who's just kind of curious and maybe checking things out, asking some questions, isn't there something attractive? Because the church, which is not a building, it's not an hour on Sunday morning where we just come together and do a service, that's part of it. But the church, which is the gathering of people following Jesus, coming together to worship, to love God, to be loved by God, to love other people, to be on that kind of mission, we're called to be something alternative to our culture. We're called to be an alternative, to present an alternative way of living. And here is the truth. While that's intimidating, it's also for so many of us attractive. Because there's things in our lives and in our culture where we go, this really isn't working for us. Not just for me, although that's a tension you've probably felt. There's certain ways of thinking, there's certain ways of living where maybe you've got to a point where you go, this isn't work. This isn't leading me to a better place, a healthier place, even a happier place. This isn't leading me to whatever you might define as the good life. And so we look for an alternative. And many of us, we are looking for an alternative, even if it's kind of uncomfortable, even if it's different, we go, oh yeah, but different is something that I need right now. And I actually think Canada is one of the best places to live. I am feel so privileged to live in Canada. I was born in Canada. I've lived here my entire life. I think it's one of the best places in the world. I think that there are some beautiful and wonderful parts of our culture. That should be celebrated. I think there are aspects of our culture and people in our culture who are doing great things. I think some of the attention that is being put towards solving some of the big problems that we have and that we always have in our general culture is really, really good. And I love that. But there's also some areas where I go, man, I need an alternative. I need something different because this way of living, I just don't think works. I don't think it works for me as an individual or for us collectively. We actually need something different. And that experience in some of the terminology of the scripture is the experience of living in exile, living in a place where you are not the majority, where your values, where your thoughts, where the way that you want to live out your life is what the majority is thinking. And so in the Old Testament or the Jewish scriptures, what we have a record of is the broad story, right? Just broad story is you have the people of Israel. Where did they come from? How did they show up? Where did God reveal himself to them? What did he call them to? And one of the things he did is he called them out to be different, to provide an alternative culture to the culture, an alternative way of living in order to be a light. In scripture language to Abram, the patriarch of the people of Israel, it was a call that he would be blessed. God would bless him in order to bless everybody else. So I'm going to bless, God's saying, I'm going to give you my presence. I'm going to give you just everything that I have, this love for you, so that you can spread that to the world, because the world needs something different. The world oftentimes needs an alternative. And then if you look at that picture in the Old Testament of the people of Israel, God promises them as a part of that, I'm going to give you a land, a place where you can go and you can kind of set up as a people group. And from there, the point was always to be a blessing, but that didn't always happen. And the people of Israel sometimes went the wrong way and did the wrong thing. They assimilated in ways that they weren't supposed to with people around them. And oftentimes what we see in scripture happens a number of times is that the people of Israel go into exile. So another nation maybe comes in, conquers them from a military perspective, spreads them out, pushes them out, takes the people and says, you can't live here anymore, takes them to another place. And that's part of the point of what these other enemy nations did is we don't want you to be different. We want to run how things go. And so we're going to take you, we're going to spread you all out, and we're going to put you in places where you're supposed to become like us. And then the challenge of God's people was to say, now that we are not in the place where we have control over so much of our lives and even our religious practices and what we're supposed to do, how do we figure it out? How do we live while we're in exile? Hoping that one day we'll get back to a place we're not in exile, a place where we're at peace, a place where we can be who we want to be. We can worship as we worship. We can live as we live. And yet living in an alternate reality where they are in exile, often asking themselves, are we still blessed by God? Is God still around? Because off the way that they would think was when we're in our land and things are going well and we really feel the blessings, right? We're prosperous. We have some money. We have some stuff going for us. We're not at war with anybody. That's when we know that God is with us and God is for us and God is blessing us. Well, what happens when none of that is true, when we're struggling? And in the New Testament, what we get is some of that same language often used of exile, but now applied not to geography and not just to the people of Israel, but to those of us who are slaves to sin, not always another nation, but when we're being enslaved by ways of thinking and by ways of acting that are not good for us, are not healthy for us, are not leading to human flourishing in the best possible way, which is one way to translate what we read earlier in one of the songs, talking about eternal life. Eternal life, the good life, however we might define that. Biblically, we might define that in the best possible way, the life that God created us for, a life with him, a life of love, a life in proper relationships with each other, a life where we care for each other and love for each other, and those who don't have enough are made sure that they are provided for and cared for and all that kind of stuff. But all that to say is, for Christians, we live with a sense of exile, that we're in exile. As the people of Israel had to try and figure out, what does it look like to live when we're spread out and when things aren't going the way that we want them to? Christians often feel that as well. And like I said, there's something intimidating about that and also something attractive. Man, I need an alternative. I need a different way of living because this isn't always working. Biblical scholar Walter Brueggemann talks about exile in these terms. He says it's the experience of knowing that one is an alien and perhaps even in a hostile environment where the dominant values run counter to one's own. So when I am the other, when I am the one who doesn't fit in, when I am the one that feels like everybody's going in a different direction, that makes me very uncomfortable. I am not the, and so if you are a boomer or Gen X, there's a chance that you experienced a time here in Canada where Christianity did have a fairly dominant place, or at least a more dominant place, a more visible place in our culture, that it was a little bit more common for people. If you're a Gen Z or millennial, you've never experienced that. You just haven't. It's just, we believe it or not, I'm top end of millennial. I am there. But for us, it's just we've never been in a culture where Christianity culturally had a pretty dominant and visible place. It's got, and, you know, I referred to being in Texas and having the weather report and all that kind of stuff. Well, our American friends are now going through what we went through in Canada, a generation ago or more. They are now seeing some of those same things, which is the dominant force, way of thinking, religious or not religious way of doing things is more and more in North America secular. And I don't say that to be antagonistic. I have lots of friends who would be completely secular, have no religion, no faith, and maybe even no interest in those things. But to just call it out and to say the church is an alternative to that. The church is one that says we still believe that there's a God, and that we can know something about that God, hopefully not in a real proud way, like we have all the answers and we figured everything else, but we believe that we can know something about God, specifically for Christians, that we believe that God looks like Jesus, that Jesus reveals to us God's heart and what God looks like. And if we're wondering, what do you think God is like? And there's tons of ideas out there, and maybe the predominant one, again, in our culture is that there isn't one, or that if there is one, we don't know what that God is like. Christians, we come back and say at the core, we believe that God revealed himself ultimately in Jesus, and that is the perfect picture of a God that we cannot see. And that is where our alternative way of thinking and believing and living comes from, even when we feel like we are maybe in exile a little bit, because I think we are. There's a couple of ways we could deal with that I would say are not great ways, although a lot of us have bought into it. And a lot of times it becomes part of church culture, unfortunately. So how do we deal with the fact that Christianity is not in the majority, and a lot of people think differently, and then all the tensions, all that kind of stuff. Well, one way people have gone about it is that we need to isolate ourselves. We need to be separate. We need to withdraw. We need to keep everybody else at bay. We don't want to be influenced by anybody else, and so in order to make sure that we're not being negatively influenced, we kind of shrink into ourselves. We try and stay away from everybody else as much as we can, and isolation becomes a strategy. Some of us have not only adopted this as a practical way of living, but theologically we've bought into this. Well, what's going to happen in terms of what God is doing? We have even isolation or withdraw theologies that say things like, we're just supposed to stay separate enough for long enough until Jesus comes and then he's going to whisk us away to heaven. We don't have to really worry about this world. So just kind of, I'm going to stay isolated so that I don't get polluted by everybody else and negatively impacted until Jesus comes, takes us away to heaven, and we'll be done with the world. The problem is that's really not what Scripture says. It's not what Jesus taught. In fact, Jesus taught us when he taught us how to pray, what? That we would pray that heaven would come here. Not that we would just go to heaven. I'm not saying I don't believe in heaven, but our job is to welcome the things of God into this world, not to just think that we're going to withdraw from them. Also, theologically, very clear, in the New Testament is that the trajectory is that God is going to bring us a new heaven and a new earth, not just float away to heaven in your spirit and forget about the earth. He's about renewal. And so just saying, I'm going to withdraw, I'm going to be isolated until I float away to heaven, really is not a good interpretation of what Jesus or other New Testament writers tell us about what God wants to do. He cares desperately for this earth, for the world. We started in this series, for God so loved the world that he sent his son. Not that he stayed withdrawn and said, I'm going to withdraw you one day, but that we're going to come into. Second thing that we do sometimes is we demonize other people that aren't like us, because I think it's easy to rally around an enemy. Just think about that for a second. It's so easy to demonize someone else or something else, create an enemy for us to fight, and then rally us all around that enemy, to be negative, to be hateful, to be, that's our problem, to be scapegoating sometimes, that's our problem. And this is not just for religious people or Christian people. It's just so much easier for us to be negative and to find an enemy. In fact, if you see this in, I hate to bring this up. You see this in politics all the time. It's easier to demonize your opponent and to rally around that than to come up with constructive and productive solutions to our real problems, isn't it? All I know is they're not going to help you. They're bad. They're evil. They're going in this direction. They're going to ruin our country. They're going to ruin our nation. They're going to ruin. And Christians, we can easily do that. You know what the problem is? And we talked about this when we defined what the world means in the Bible. It can mean a number of different things. But in John chapter 3, where we looked at, for God so loved the world, we said he's not talking about the people of the world or the planet, our world. God loves the world. Sorry, he is talking about those things. In other places where we're told not to love the world, what are we talking about when we talk about the world? We're talking about the systems and those ways of thinking that lead us away from human flourishing. That is, living in right relationship with God and with other people. And so those things we're not supposed to engage in, but we are supposed to engage with the people of the world in our planet with bringing heaven to earth. That is the call. But it's much easier to just say there's a bunch of problems, and guess what? The problems are over there. It's with those people and that person. And we demonize them, and then we can rally around, we have an enemy. Hey, everybody who thinks that person, those people, this thing is the enemy, hey, come with us. And it's easy to become complainers, and to become negative, and to become deconstructors, and to tear everything down. Easier, easier, easier. Harder is to rally around something positive, and around solutions, and around making things better. And so I can see why we do that. It's easier to withdraw, and it's easier to become demonizing of other people. Complaining is easier than being constructive. Putting down is easier than building up. Pointing out problems is easier than solving them. Talking about people is easier than taking care of people. Being against something is easier than being for something. And yet, we are called to be an alternative. And my heart for Westside Church, for those of us who are here in the room, for those of us following online, for those of us who are geographically in Hamilton and those of us who aren't, is that we would be known more about what we're for than what we're against. That when we read a verse like, for God so loved the world that he sent his son, we would say, and that becomes our mission too. And you go, oh, so that means you don't care about all the stuff that you should be against? Not what I said. That we would be known more for who we're for, what we're for, than what we're against. That would be our rally. It's easy to just rally around all the stuff that we hate and to complain and to deconstruct and all that kind of stuff. That's easy, and everybody does it. But what if there was a group of people? What if there was a group of people? And historically, this is when the church, capital C church, not one church, Westside Church, but church across the world, those who gather in the name of Jesus, this is when the church grows, is when as an alternative, people see a different way where people love the world around them. Where it's not the majority, it's not the easy thing. It doesn't just look like every other aspect of life is, but when there's this deep expression of love, even in the midst of sometimes, again, not so much us in North America, but sometimes being persecuted, being the minority, being left out, and people go, that's okay, that sounds a lot like Jesus, but we're gonna be here to love the world around us because that's who God is. Oh, it's just so much harder. The early church, you know what they were known for? Because sometimes I think, what if, again, we live in a very secular culture. It's established. A lot of people around us are, when it comes to things of faith, are suspicious, maybe even cynical. I get that. But do you know what happened in the early church? Because the early church, same thing. I mean, this is not new. But the early church, there was a lot of people who looked around and said, man, I don't know about what they believe. Very pluralistic societies, right? Oftentimes, I'm thinking first century, second century, third century, believed in a lot of gods, believed in certain types of gods that did certain things. And the Christian God, you know, the monotheism, there's one God, and this is who we believe he is and what he looks like, was very foreign to them. But the things that stood out to people, and we have writings of this, because they were like emperors who they were very threatened by Christianity because all these people would want to sign up and live differently, and it was a threat to the people and the religions and the politics who had control. And so there were some times where they would get somebody to go investigate, like, what are these Christians all about? And sometimes they would come back and they go, I don't really know, but here's what I know. They're really generous with their stuff. Like, they just give away everything, and anybody who has a need, they make sure has enough. They really are out there for people who are vulnerable and don't have enough. Like, they care, and this was wildly counter-cultural Because oftentimes, you know, in some of those cultures, it was if you were disabled, if you were poor, if you were anything other than maybe what people thought of as sort of normal or in the majority, it was like, well, there's a reason for that, and we can kind of leave you off to the side. So like hospitals, orphanages, all these kind of things were very Christian things to be started. And so these reports would come back, well, they're super generous, and they care for people who are vulnerable. The way that they treat women was extremely progressive in their cultures. Like, man, they treat women like people. And again, some of us, that's foreign to us because recently of where our culture is at, but that was very different for them. And they go, man, these people, I don't know about what they believe in, but they're super generous. And they love people and really care for people. And you know what? They stick to their marriages. Those were like the three big things. Like, they don't run out on their marriages and you know, commit adultery and all those kind of things. Like, that's what Christians, you know, all the other stuff, we don't know about what they believe, but these are the pretty obvious things. It was an alternative, it was a hugely alternative way of living. I want to read to you from a really powerful passage in Jeremiah chapter 29. If you have a Bible, turn with me, Jeremiah 29. We're going to have to go quick here. But this is a time where the people are in exile in Babylon, which they had been taught was pretty much the most wicked place on the face of the earth. This was their enemies. They went against everything religiously, culturally, that the people of Israel were supposed to stand for. They found themselves there after being conquered, kicked out of their land, struggling. Does God love us? Is he blessing us? How do we deal with this? And there was a prophet who went out. His name was Hananiah, and he was out there telling people, don't worry, this isn't going to last very long. We're going back to our nation. Don't get comfortable here. Don't even worry about it. God's just going to save us, and he's going to whisk us away. And then God gets really mad because that's not what God said. It was a really easy thing for people to hear. Oh, don't worry, you're not going to be in Babylon long. We're going back. We're going back. And then God comes and speaks through Jeremiah, and he comes with a different message. Jeremiah 29, verse 4 says, thus said the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Wait a second. This did not catch God off guard. What, God, we're not in the right place. God, we've been kicked out of the land. Maybe you didn't know. And God says, I know. I was with you. I sent you there. This is on purpose. I know we're not the people of Israel in Babylon, but I want you to consider, perhaps, especially if you feel discontent with where you're at, geographically, with your job, with your family, with your surroundings, that maybe God has you exactly where he wants you. I just want you to think about that. Maybe you are exactly where God wants you to make an impact and a difference, even if it's not the place you thought you wanted to be or should be right now. Just think about that. You are where you are for a reason. The people of Israel were, well, we're supposed to be back in Israel. This is where I sent you. Verse 5, he says, build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat their produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease. In other words, you're not going anywhere soon. Settle in, build a house, get married, have children, raise your children here. Let them get married. This is going to take a few generations. As a parent, what's our biggest desire as a parent? It's our kids, right? We want what's best for our kids. We want them to grow up. We want them, if we're Christians, we probably want them to know Jesus and to love God and to be loved by God and to love other people and to have those characteristics. We want to protect them. We want to huddle them. We want to make sure that they're not negatively affected. We want everything that's good for them. That's what parents want. And God says, here's what you need to do for your kids. Stay here, raise them here. Maybe more than protecting our kids, we need to get them on mission. I know that's really, really intimidating. It is for me as a parent with young kids. But maybe my biggest goal is not to protect them from the world, but try and teach them and nurture them in such a way that they can live in the world, in exile. That's tougher, isn't it? Well, let's go over here and make sure our kids are never affected by the world. I don't know. I don't know if you could ever really do that anyway. I don't know if it's productive, but what if we started thinking as parents, as a church for the next generation, what if we started inspiring our kids and teaching them what it looks like to live when they're not amongst the majority? And we teach them how important getting a grip on their identity is, because it's going to be challenged and it's going to be hard, and they're going to be tempted to just be like everybody else. And we said, we know that's coming. So why don't we work on that? That's hard. But God's saying to them, you build houses, you put down roots. I mean, your kids are going to be here. Your grandkids are going to be here. So then verse 7, he says, but seek the welfare or the peace. This word is shalom in Hebrew. Seek the shalom of the city where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf. And then get this. For in its welfare or peace, you will find welfare or peace. Here's the key. I just got to get out of here. This is a bad, wicked, awful place. Okay, maybe there's a different way of looking at it. You seek the peace of where you're at. Because when the city is at peace, you'll be at peace. Their welfare is your welfare. As the city goes, so you go. You want your kids to grow up in a great place? Be part of the solution. Be part of constructing. I get it. We could just cower in the corner. Everything's bad. Everything's evil. I don't want to be, and I don't want my kid anywhere near. Okay, but maybe God has us right where he wants us to make a difference. And if we would seek the peace of our city, if we would make it important that people around us would have what they need, physically, spiritually. Yesterday we did a food drive because there's people who are in need. Let's seek the peace of people who are in need because what's good for them is good for all of us. This is what God's doing in our world. Why don't we join him? Why don't we part of it? Be part of what he's doing. It's easier just to shrink away and isolate ourselves and say everybody else is the problem, so we'll just be over there in the corner until Jesus comes, except that's not what Jesus taught us to do. It's not what the New Testament teaches us to do. It's not even what the Old Testament teaches us to do. Seek the peace of the city. Seek the welfare of the city and its welfare. Imagine we really believe this about Hamilton, about Dundas, about Ancaster, about the city that you live in. The peace of Hamilton is where you'll find your peace. Probably change your priorities. Probably change how you spend your time. Peace or shalom, here translated welfare, means holistic flourishing. To be blessed, to bless those who are around us, to be prosperous. And I don't mean that in a materialistic way that we just want a lot of money and luxury and all that kind of stuff. I mean, when people have what they need for human flourishing, when we're caring for people who are in need, when we're addressing not just our physical needs, maybe our mental health needs and our spiritual needs deeply, when we're really caring for other people. Oh, man. Okay, let me skip down to verse 11. This is where we read this verse this morning. For those of us who are in the room, this is a really powerful one. This is a verse, this is one of those verses that people use as a life verse. You write it in your Bible and you highlight it, you paint it on your wall in your house or your apartment. We use it oftentimes when you're worried about what program you're going to get into in school, what job you should have, maybe if you want to have kids and you're trying to have kids, something like that. And we sort of co-opt it and go, okay, and to a point that's okay, but it says this, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for peace or welfare, and not for evil, to give you a future and to give you hope." So we go, great, God wants to give me the job that I want. He's got a future for me. And that's not a terrible thing. I get that. But look at the context of this. The context is people are in exile where they're thinking, I'm not supposed to be here. This is an evil world that I've been put into that I need to escape. And he goes, stay there and just know, because I know that I have a plan for you. And my plan for you is a good plan. It's not evil. It's to give you hope and a future. And you say, but my future is not here. And God says, maybe it is. But I know the plan I have for you. I have it for you. Maybe you and I and us as a church are right where we need to be for God to do something powerful in us and through us. It's the context of this, is the people of Israel. It's not even for us, although I think it's very applicable. Right where you are, God says, I have a plan for you. Remember when he said, seek the peace of the city, seek the welfare of the city? If we go down to verse 13, it says, and I don't think this is an accident. I think this is very on purpose. You will seek, God speaking, me. You will seek, remember, seek the welfare of the peace of the city. You will seek me and find me. It's the same word now. When you seek me with all your heart. What does that mean in this context? When you seek also the prosperity of the city, the peace of the city, when you care for the people around you, the institutions around you, the needy around you, your city, go and seek the peace. And then maybe you'll be finding me because you'll be seeking me. That's where I'm at. He says, I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all nations and all places where I have driven you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. I want good for you. I'm bringing you back. I've got a good plan for you, but right now I need you to get on board in blessing those around you. We are where we need to be to make a difference. So real quick as we close, I want to introduce to you a couple of things that I think is really important for us over the next 6 weeks as we end the year. Number one, and if you're new, maybe you've never heard this, but if you've been around a while, hopefully you've heard this. At Westside, we want to be a church that unchurched people love to attend. Because we want to be a people where your friends, your neighbors, who maybe are very secular, who are very, I don't know, maybe cynical, maybe questioning things, maybe have no even category for faith or desire to be part of faith. But what if we were the kind of people who thought so much about the peace around us, they were like, I don't know about the whole God thing. I don't know about the whole church thing. I don't know about the beliefs. I don't know about a guy who's risen from the dead. I don't know if I could ever believe in that. I don't know about miracles. I don't know about da-da-da-da-da-da. But here's one thing I know. Those people are weirdly loving. They are weirdly generous. I don't get it, but they give away their money and their stuff to a level that is so weird. That they are so committed to their community. That if they weren't here, I don't know about all the things they believe, but if they weren't here, this neighborhood, this city would be different. These people just, man, there's something about them. What if we were known more for what we're for than all the things we might be against? Man, that's just such a powerful thing. It's easy to rally against what we're against, and we could all just huddle in here, but would it be harder if maybe we just thought, maybe this is kind of like what God said to us. I get where you're at, and I get that sometimes it's just so hard to live different from the people around you, and you don't believe the same things all the time. Seek the peace of Hamilton. Seek the peace of Ancaster. Seek the peace of Dundas. Seek the peace of Burlington. Seek the peace of Sarnia. Seek the peace of whatever your city is, whatever the people around you. Seek the peace of your family that doesn't think like you or believe like you or show up to church like you. Your friends, your neighbors, because their peace will be our peace. This is God so loved the world that he sent his son into the world, and so do we. Here's two things we're going to do over the next 6 weeks. I'd love for you to join us. I want you, today I'm going to introduce us. We're going to talk about more for the rest of the year. Two things. I want you to consider to be for people. That is, I want you to prayerfully consider, start today, four people, four couples, four families, whatever you want. It's not really about four. It was just that there was two fours and I thought that was memorable. Could be five, could be 10. Keep it manageable. But there's four people that I'm going to be for over the next, start with 6 weeks till the end of the year, Christmas time. People I'm going to invite, you're going to hear in a couple of minutes in our announcements, we're going to have a tree lighting and a Christmas market here to kick off the Christmas season in a couple of weeks. Have some fun, have some community, bring people around. People that maybe church is so weird for them, you say, come to the most easy thing to come to in terms of church. It's not intimidating in any way. We're going to have a Christmas tree lighting. It's going to be fun. But maybe you get to come to meet some of my community. Maybe you just come and it's one step. We're going to talk over the next month about our Christmas Eve services, a time where historically more guests, people who don't normally come to church, are willing to accept an invitation than any other time of the year, just because it's Christmas and it's still a cultural thing, even though our culture is very post-Christian. But maybe it's a time you'll say, I'm going to invite some people. I'm going to invite them over to my house afterwards. Maybe we can talk about it a little bit. We can have dinner. We can have fun. And they can just realize, hey, this is a big part of who I am. This is my identity, whatever that might look like. But who are four people that you can start praying for? Next week, we're going to give you some tools to help you with that. Start praying for them. Start inviting them. Maybe enter into conversations with them that are a little bit deeper than normal. And then second, be committed to community. And this is a bit of a reminder and a bit of a kickoff today. Every year, this time of year, at the end of the year, we do some fundraising for some things that we believe God's put on our heart. Back in the spring and summer, we kicked off our Committed to Community Fund. Primarily what this is for is two things we've added to a little bit. One is our Christmas outreaches this year. So I've just talked about them. This time where we have a Christmas tree lighting and our Christmas Eve services where we just want to share the good news of Jesus with people. Let them know that we're here. Invite them to come back and be part of this. The second thing is here at Westside, we really believe God is calling us to prepare ourselves to bring on a new staff member, another pastoral role, somebody who can help us to build a deep and wide community like this, to really care for people in our church and outside of our church and to help carry the load of that because we believe God has called us to reach the people who right now are not in church, who maybe have no real sense of God in their lives in Ancaster and in Dundas, in Hamilton. We believe that the time is right. We believe that there's opportunity. We believe coming out of the climate that we have come out of in the last 2 years that there are people who are searching and that we can share with them and be the kind of people who really seek their peace. We care about you so much. We're going to go out to you. And we want to bring on somebody who can help us to do that. And the first step in that, we got to do a couple of things. The first step financially is we need to put some money in the bank to help us on the front end of that salary. And then we need to catch up in terms of our budget. But for this Christmas, what we're asking is for you to jump on board to fund those two projects. Here's the price tag. It's going to cost above and beyond what we normally do, $41,500. It's a lot of money. It's a lot of money for us. It would be an act of faith for us to step out. It will mean some of us, hopefully all of us, will dig really deep and give not just out of our excess, but sacrificially. Because we believe that seeking the peace of the city, we believe in investing in what God is doing is more important than some of the other things we might do with our money. It's like the early church, we might just be so generous. People would go, how do people give away that much money? Why would they be willing to? Man, because we love you, city. We love you, Hamilton. Here's the good news. We started fundraising for some of this back in the spring and summer, and in pledges and gifts already given, $23,000 has been raised from you guys. Amazing. Some of you are newer than that. It's the first time you're hearing about this, but there's people who have put out some significant money. So here's what's left, $18,500 over the next 6 weeks or so. I'm going to ask you to pray about that, think about that. If you're married, to talk to your spouse about that, and maybe there's a number that's God's putting on your heart. Again, it's going to require from us, a church our size and where we're at, it's going to require a lot from us. Some of us are going to have to dig deep to make sure that this happens. But I believe that there are people who are part of this church that believe so deeply in this text that we read today that it applies to us and what Jesus calls to us in seeking first the kingdom of God, in praying for heaven to come to earth, that this is something that's more important than the other things we have in our lives. So first, thank you for those of you who have already reflected what I just said by getting us to this point. Couldn't do this without you. Could not do this without you. And for the rest of us, I just encourage you over the next 6 weeks to consider what God might be calling you to do, to participate in this in terms of inviting people, in terms of giving. And then as we go along, every week to being part of this community, a community that loves the people around us, to build a church that unchurched people love to attend, because even if they're not sure, but all the things that we believe yet, they see something infectious about the people that make up this community, seeking the peace of our city, of the people around us. If you want to give to this fund, just mark it committed to community at our giving station on the way out or online. It'll ask you for a giving type at some point. Just click committed to community and you can do that. And I'm really looking forward to celebrating what God's going to do. We don't always know what he's going to do, how he's going to work. But I really believe at this point in our history, as a church, but also as a community, as people who live in this area, people who live in Canada, people who live in a post-Christian world, that there's an alternative. That people are still looking for meaning and purpose and the best possible life. And I believe with all my heart that the best possible answer that we could give to those people is Jesus.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your hands, this is my comfort. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still.
Yeah.
You can go ahead and grab another quick seat here. Thanks so much for joining us. I just have a few details to get into before we head out, as we've been challenged today to be 4-4 and to be thinking about committed to community. So first thing, when you came in, there was a Westside Christmas Market and tree lighting invite. So it has all the details there for our event on December 4th, which is a Saturday. It's happening between 4 and 6 p.m. And take that. On the back, it's blank. I encourage you to, if you're extending that invitation to somebody else, write a little message, give them some details, let them know that you'll be there and you'd love them to join you. Like Dave said, we want to be thinking about who we're investing in this Christmas and who we can invite. So this is a super practical way to do it. It's a couple weeks away. And so mark that on your calendar. Really looking forward to it. The second thing, we are... like Dave touched on, our committed to community campaign. So I have a giving slide here just to remind you of a few ways that you can give. You can give in the lobby at the end of the service. There's debit and credit terminal there. You can give online at any point, or cash and debit. And if you're giving specifically to committed to community, please designate that, and we'll make sure that that goes towards making sure we can raise $18,500 until the rest of the year. And lastly, Advent. So next week, Advent starts. We're getting right into Christmas season. So we'll be starting a four-week series called All I Want for Christmas. And we're going to be looking at themes of hope, love, joy, and peace. So that's 4 weeks leading up to Christmas and Christmas Eve. And I want to let you know that we have Advent devotional guides. So we have 100 or so copies. So it's first come, first serve. They're on the table on your way out if you want to grab one of those. But you can also get a digital copy if you go to beinchrist.ca/Advent. So these Advent guides are put on by our denomination, Be in Christ. We're so thankful to have these as a Christmas resource. So I encourage you to read through it as it starts next Sunday, November 28th. Now, as you guys head out, I just want to remind you, COVID protocols, we will start the back rows to go out and just kind of stay seated until everyone's kind of shuffled out. We ask that you go through the front door to exit. And then if you are new and maybe you signed up or maybe you didn't, if you want to join us for next, it's happening right now after the service in a classroom at the end of the hall in our basement. So we encourage you just to step outside, go around the building and come back in. Meet us down there just for a little bit of time. You'll get to meet some leaders, answer any questions you have at Westside Church, and just hear more about us, our mission and strategy, what we're all about. So thanks to those who signed up. If you didn't, we have room, we have space. Join us for next today, right after the service. So that's everything. You guys are dismissed, and I hope you have a great week and a great rest of your Sunday. Thanks for being with us.
Sound was once lost, but I'm now found.